All right, so for number 3A, a confidence interval is a range of reasonable values used to estimate what? So, remember that a sample statistic is just something that you calculate from the data. So you don't need to really estimate that. You know it exactly as soon as you do all the calculations on your data. The sampling distribution of the sample statistic is also, again, is known from your data, right? So you don't really need to estimate that either. And same with the shape of the sampling distribution. So really what we're after with a confidence interval is to look for a range of reasonable values for a population parameter, okay? So part B asks, which of the following does not need to be known to compute the p-value, right? So we just go back to the definition for the p-value, and we note that the p-value is just going to be some area on the sampling distribution. So we can say it's here. So we definitely do need to know the value of the test statistic, because otherwise we don't know where to draw this dotted line that shows the cutoff for our for where we shade in our p-value. We definitely need to know the direction of the extreme, otherwise we could have shaded in, very well have shaded in this area as well, and we wouldn't know which one to pick. And of course we do need to know the distribution, this distribution overall. Otherwise we wouldn't be able to wouldn't be able to make an appropriate assessment of how much this shaded area is. So the only thing that's left is the level of significance. So it's important to note that the level of significance is a key part of your hypothesis test, but it's something that you get to set at the beginning of the process. So and the only time you use it is at the very end, where you evaluate how likely if your p-value is enough in your with your set level of significance to accept or reject. So it's used to evaluate your p-value, not to compute it. Okay, so part C, a 95% confidence interval is computed. Which of the following values will definitely be within the limits of this confidence interval? So they're saying there exists some confidence interval, and this comes from your data. Remember, confidence intervals are generated from your data. So this is a range of values generated by your data, and in the middle of it, assuming that we have a symmetric distribution, which we normally do in this class, is your sample mean. So your sample mean is definitely inside of your confidence interval. Even if the distribution is not symmetric, as an aside, you would still see the sample mean somewhere in this range. The population mean does not have to be in this range. We certainly do expect it to be in the range, but there's always a chance that we selected some bad data points and, you know, the true mu is out here. The standard deviation of the sample mean is not even on the same scale, and of course none of the above doesn't make sense because we know it's a sample mean. Okay. Part D says, a researcher recruits 15 people to participate in her survey. She analyzes the results, gets a p-value of 0.12. Her significance level was 10%. So she's comparing the p-value of 0.12 to significance level of 10%. So definitely she should not reject a null hypothesis because her p-value is more than her significance level, right? So by rule, right, that says... But by her own test setup, right, she said that she wanted the 10% p-value to reject, and she'd not get it. So this is just a rule that she set up for herself that that she should not reject the null hypothesis. This proves that her experimental treatment has no effect on memory. The word proves should be a red flag here, because she hasn't really proved anything. It's a very, she just has said, you know, there's not enough evidence to reject the null hypothesis, that there's no effect on memory. So, whenever you see the word proves, basically, there should be a red flag going up, but, the third option is there could be a treatment effect, but sample size is too small to detect it. This is certainly a true statement, right, because, it's really a really weak statement. They're saying there could be a treatment effect. They're not saying there is a treatment effect. So it's certainly true that perhaps if the sample size was bigger, they could detect this hypothetical treatment effect that may or may not be there. And the last part of this question is an actual calculation. So let's take a look. Basically, we want to know the minimum sample size to get a 90% confidence with a margin of error of no more than 90% confidence with a margin of error no more than 5%. We want the minimum sample size. So we go to our formula card, and I can show you where this is. Right. So here is the formula we want to use for this, right? Because we're looking at a confidence interval for a population proportion, okay? So that formula is n, which is the minimum sample size, equals Z star, right, over 2 times M squared, where Z star is determined by the 90% confidence, right? So to get a 90% coverage on a normal, zoom in a little bit here. And rewrite this. So, to get a 90% coverage on our normal, right, we know that this area has to be 90%. And by the empirical rule, we know that this is about 1.645. And if you look at, if you just look up this value on your table, you'll be able to see the same thing. Now the 2 is obvious. M is your significance level. So M is given in the problem, right? This is M. So we do the calculation. It's just N equals 1.645 over 2 times 0.05 squared. And the final answer is 271.